So last week was Transfiguration Sunday, and all around the world, the Church of Jesus Christ was reading a passage in Matthew. I want you to turn to that today, because I don't want you to miss this. Matthew 17, right at the beginning. Go ahead and find your Bible, just Google Matthew 17 and call that up. Because something completely amazing happens in Matthew 17. It's ridiculous. It doesn't make any sense. There's no context in your human walk to put this thing that happens to three of Jesus' best friends. Matthew 17. After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John and led them up on a high mountain by themselves. And there he was transfigured right before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. And just then there appeared before them Moses and Elijah, and they were chatting with Jesus. And Peter, he recognizes, this is a big deal. Jesus, you're letting us in behind the scenes. You're giving us a backstage pass to see who you really are. It's like he just kind of cracked open his robe just for a moment and let him see, I'm a superhero. You might not have known my identity before, but I'll let you know now. And Peter says, it's really good for us to be here. And then he indicates, maybe we should stay here. How about I do this? I'll build 3 shelters, one for Moses, one for you, Jesus, and one for Elijah. And while Peter was still speaking, a bright cloud covered them. And a loud voice called through the cloud, this is my son, whom I love and I'm so pleased with. Listen to him. Can you imagine this? You're seeing Jesus unveiled. You're seeing, you've been reading the Mosaic Law your whole life, and then there's Moses, and he's chit-chatting with the Son of God. And Elijah, who was swept up in a cloud and never tasted death, has come back. And he's just chilling with Jesus, and you get to see it. And then on top of all of that, the sky breaks through, and a loud voice from heaven, God's audible voice, says, that's my son, listen to him, right? And as they were coming back down the mountain, Jesus instructed them, don't tell anybody about what you've seen. Can you imagine that? Wait. You mean you just showed me that? And I can't talk about it? Really? So imagine how deep it must have gotten into their spirit. Imagine how many times they replayed it, dying to speak of it, right? And it must have just buried deep in to their spirit. So that was last week's, right? The week before Lent, historically the church looks at the transfiguration. Then we came to Ash Wednesday, and this week we begin Lent, our first week. And our 3-year Bible reading plan, the lectionary, brings us all the way back to the beginning of the story, Genesis 2. So go ahead and turn to Genesis 2 and look at verse around 15, we'll start. And watch what happens. The Lord God took the man that he had created in his image, and he put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and to take care of it. He gave it to him. And the Lord God commanded the man, you are free to eat from any of these trees. Except you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat from it, you will die. The Lord God said, it's not really good for man to be alone. I'm going to make a helper that's really suitable for him. And so the Lord comes real close to Adam and pulls him by his side and said, hey, here's what I've got for you today. We're going to have an animal parade. I'm going to bring all the wild beasts on the ground and all the birds from the air, and we're just going to have a parade. And I'm going to listen to you, Adam. And whatever name you call that animal, that's what it's going to be called. And so the animals came up one by one. The birds flew by one by one. And Adam called out what their name was. And the Lord said, oh, that's a good one. Yeah, let's call it that. Yeah, that's a good one too. Yeah, lizard. Yep, that's perfect. That's exactly what he looks like, a lizard. And God and man had that intimate relationship. Day by day, they would just draw each other close and they would listen to one another. That's the bond that they had. And the Lord looked at the whole animal parade and he said, not exactly what I'm looking for, no. So he said, Adam, come here. And he put him into this deep, deep, deep sleep. And he reached inside the man and pulled out a rib. And he sealed up the wound with flesh. And out of that rib, he formed woe man. And then he woke Adam up. Now listen, fellas. That's a good morning. When you wake up and for the first time you see God's handiwork handcrafted for you in the form of, whoa, man, right? And so Adam says, that's for me? That's you did this for me? And you made me for her? Well, now this is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh, and I'm going to call her woe man, for she was taken out of man. And this is going to be why man leaves his father and mother and gets united with his wife. And Adam and his wife, they were both naked, and they felt no shame. The story continues in chapter 3. Now the serpent was more crafty than all the wild animals that the Lord had made. And he said to the woman, so tell me, did God really say you can't eat from any of these trees? And she said, what? No, we could eat from any of the trees, just not the one in the center of the garden. Because God said, you must not touch that or you will die. And the serpent shook his head and said, you won't die. No. See, God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Then the woman looked at the tree, really took a look and saw that it was pleasing to the eye and good for food and also desirable for gaining wisdom. She thought she was gaining wisdom. And so she took some of the fruit and she ate it. She also gave it to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. And then both their eyes were opened, and they realized they were naked, and they quickly sewed together some fig leaves and tried to cover themselves. And the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord. They were familiar with this sound because, remember, the Lord draws close to them here. On a regular occurrence, he's there in the flesh, audible voice, not a mysterious spirit, but there with him. They looked at the time of day and, oh, this is Jesus, God's regular pattern. This is where the cool of the day is coming, and they hear God and he's walking through. And they ran and hid. But the Lord called to them. Hey, where are you guys? And Adam answered from the bushes. I heard you coming, Lord, and I was afraid because I'm naked, so I hid. And I've been wondering why the lectionary, our three-year Bible reading plan that we've been using for years, that churches all over the globe and the Church of Jesus Christ is using, why they put together the Transfiguration and then the week after, back to back, the story of our beginnings. I couldn't figure out exactly what they had in common, and the more I read them, the more I wondered, and then I could see it. You know, both these events, they're supernatural, they're amazing, they're way out of the ordinary human experience. You see what's happening here. In both of these stories, we see these awesome people who get to see behind the curtain. They get a backstage pass to see how awesome God really is. They get to see God in the flesh. Both Adam and Eve and the disciples, Peter, James, and John, they get to catch a glimpse of the sweetness, this awesomeness, this goodness that God really is. I mean, they've seen it, tasted it, experienced it. And then they forgot. They just simply forgot. Just for a moment, they each forgot. And I've found that's all it takes for us to be lured into sin and disobedience, to be attracted and enticed into anxiousness and concern and worry and darkness. It's all it takes for us to flirt with selfishness and rebellion is for us to forget who God really is. I mean, I wonder if Peter, James, and John could have ever forgotten what they saw up on that mountain. I mean, they weren't prepared for it. We have no indication that Jesus goes, hey, I'm about to do something crazy. Something ridiculous is about to happen. You gotta come and see. No preparation, right? He just says, come on. And he goes on a little ahead of them, gets to the top of the mountain, and they walk around the corner and see Jesus, the Son of God in all his glory, shining. Moses and Elijah. You can't, that's unforgettable, right? You can't forget this. But Peter did. And he forgot it fairly quickly, because soon after this, Jesus gets arrested. And just for a night, Peter forgets. Jesus gets arrested right after Peter just saw what happened on the mountain. And Peter's so mad that they've arrested him. He's so confused, so scared, so thrown off by Jesus' arrest that when he gets accused of being one of his followers, he immediately forgets what he's seen up on that mountain. And denies having anything to do with him. No, I don't know that man. Don't put me in with him. No, I don't even know what you're talking about. And leave me alone. I don't know this man. When he, more than any other human, knew exactly who he was. And in a moment, he forgets. Because if he had remembered, there's no way that conversation turns out the same way. There's no way that three conversations in the same night turn out the same way if he remembers what he's seen. And Adam and Eve, they remember the relationship they had with the Father, God the Father. Truly the only ones who have ever seen his face, his everything. Moses got close. He said, oh, just let me see you. And God said, well, I can't do that. That'll be way too much for you. I'll pass by you and cover you. And I'll yank my hand. You did see the tail of my robe. And Moses glows for 40 days afterwards. How awesome he is. Has that kind of nuclear effect on us. But Adam and Eve, they saw it every day. They were there. They could smell him. They could embrace him. They could hold him. God took advice from them. That's how intimate they were. Hey, what do you want to call those animals? Yeah, it's a great name. Good idea. That's the intimate relationship they had, and they forget. He walked with them and talked with them along the garden's narrow way, right? He was literally there in the flesh. They held him. And all he had ever been was good. In fact, he gifts them with the best present ever. I told you a few weeks ago, remember the gift that he gave us? The knowledge of good. And the knowledge that we have now, it's good, but it's only half. Because wouldn't it be better to only have the knowledge of good and never know the concept of evil? That makes your good gooder. Right? Because now we know what good is, but we also taste the bad. We have the sweet, but we have sour. We have joy, but we have pain. We have life, and we go through death. And they only had good. If you'd use the words cancer with them, divorce, destruction and war, violence and abuse, perversions and sin, they would have looked at you funny and said, I don't understand any of those words. They would have meant nothing to them. That's what God gifted them with. And it's so awesome, the relationship they have with the Father, and then right in the middle of them enjoying the everyday, sweet, intimate, gentle, trusting relationship with God the Father, they begin a conversation with the enemy, and they forget. They forget what they've seen God do. They forget what they've seen Him be. They just simply forget, and they get fooled. And I always want the Lord to show up in the middle of this conversation. I've read Genesis 3 1,000 times, and I want it to end differently. I want God the Father to show up and just go, you know what? I'm not going to wait for the cool of the day. I'm going to go out a little early, get a tan. It'll be nice and warm. I'm just going to go to the garden a little bit early. Hey, guys. What? Oh, Eve, who are you talking to? Hey, oh, the serpent. Why? That's weird. What are you guys talking about, huh? Because if that had happened, can you imagine the difference? You know what would have happened, right? Kids, you know what happened. You're doing some things that you know you maybe ought not do. And your mom and dad walk into the room. You're watching something that you know maybe you ought not be watching, and your mother walks in and says, hey, I brought popcorn. What are we watching? Remote power. Sesame Street is what I was watching. And you remember. Adults were a presence in kids' lives, mostly to remind them, right? We don't leave kids just unattended, running wild, because they quickly forget, right? And I always want God to show up and just be a presence, because Eve would have been snapped back to reality. Oh, Father, hey, I'm talking to this snake. It's weird. I don't know what he's saying. He's talking crazy stuff. He's telling me that you're holding back some really good stuff, but that doesn't seem like you at all. You haven't never done that. You just keep giving us. Adam, right? Only good. You've been so good. You're crazy. You're not even talking. Get out of here. Thank you very much. But don't tell me again how much my Father loves me. Okay? Don't tell me that he's trying to. I can't trust him. That's enough. Get out of here. That would have happened. And it would have changed the course of human history. But she forgets. That's all she does. She just forgets. You know, the word remember shows up in the Bible over 150 times. You know why? Because it's one of our biggest problems. We frail, weak, forgetful humans. We forget. I hear people that have fallen into sin say in my office all the time, Pastor, I always said I wouldn't do that. And then I forgot. forgot some of the commitments I made. I put it on a list. I made a list of the things I would not do, and I must have misplaced that list because I've done some of those things. I forgot. Pastor, I never wanted to cheat on my spouse. I never wanted to do that. You were there. You did our wedding. I mean, and you heard me say, forever faithful only to you. I'm only going to be attracted to you. I'm only going to entertain you. I'm only going to flirt with you. And I meant that, but I think I forgot. I forgot how great they were. I forgot what I loved about them. I forgot what attracted to me them in the first place, and I got swept up into something else. The other night on television, I saw a really good depiction of remembering, and I wanted to share it with you today. It's about this woman in a band. And she was in this band in college, but now she's got a family and everything. They've recruited her back. And some things happen. Take a listen.
You seem off.
Yeah, I'm okay. I just have a lot on my mind.
All right. Well, maybe this will cheer you up. Booking agent, saw his play last week,
Wants
to be part of an East Coast tour. It's just going to be us, a couple of other great jazz bands. We're going to be playing on actual stages to actual crowds.
Wow. Ben, that's amazing.
That's it? That's amazing?
It's really great. I just have to talk to Jack because I have a family. I can't really just pick up and go.
Becca, you deserve this. If Jack really loves you, he'll understand.
I'm sorry, if Jack really loves me, what is that?
I didn't...
You do realize my husband works 10, sometimes 12 hours a day, and he comes home absolutely exhausted. And since I've joined this band, he's picked up all the slack at home just so I could be here. Both of my boys play football, and he leaves work early every time so he can be there for each and every one of their games. And they're on different teams, by the way, just so they know that someone's in the stands there to support them and love them. When we play that piano gig and he's already gone to bed, he always leaves me a glass of water on my bedside table because he's worried I'm not drinking enough water, especially when I'm singing. So please, Ben, please do not tell me what Jack would do if he really loved me. My husband's a freaking superhero, and you have no idea what you're talking about.
Sorry.
It's okay.
I overstepped.
It's okay. Have a good night.
See what she did there? Did you catch what she did? Nothing superhuman. Nothing all that amazing, nothing all that out of the ordinary. You know what she did, right? All she did was remember. While the band's going to go on tour, while the band's going to get signed to a label, wow, we're going to go out to the East Coast and really start to blow up and get big. Man, I've always kind of dreamed of those kind of things, but I'm going to go talk with my husband. Well, if your husband really loved you, I mean, you deserve this. If your husband really loved you, you know, he'll be just fine with this. And she says, wait a minute. Let me remind you. Let me remind myself how much that man loves me. Let me count the ways. Let me list them off. How much he has proven and shown he loves me. So I'll thank you. Next time you want to question my husband's love for me, to shut your mouth. Because I know better than anybody else how much he loves me. And oh, how I wish Adam and his bride Eve would have stepped into the conversation and said, wait a minute. I'm sorry. Are you saying that I can't trust my trustworthy Father who's only shown me love? Are you saying that he might be trying to trick me? I'm sorry. Let me remember for you all the ways he's been good, faithful, gentle, kind, reliable, trustworthy. And he's never shown me a hint of what you're describing. Some sort of devious plan to keep all the good stuff from me. So you know what? How about this, Satan? Shut your mouth. How about this? Get to walking. The next time you try to question how much my Father loves me, because I don't forget, I remember. That's what I do. Man, I wish Peter, sitting by a fire, approached by a little teenage girl, comes up to him and says, hey, your accent, man, that really sounds like the people Jesus used to roll with, like them Galileans and stuff. You did you know him? He's all in the news, man. They say he's a bad dude. Did you roll with him? Hey, you're darn right I roll with him. You kidding me? You know what I've seen? Dude, he took me up to a mountain and he showed me that he is God. You get his name out your mouth. I'm so proud to be affiliated with him. If they're going to string him up, string me up. I remember. That's how Jesus did it. Today's gospel passage is the temptation of Jesus. The enemy comes to Jesus and says, I know you're the Son of God, and I know, like me, you'd really like to be the one in power, and I know what you really want, and I can give them to you, dude. I can offer them to you. See, I know what your taste buds enjoy, and I can give them. I can satisfy that. Why don't you come and worship me, and I'll provide that for you. And Jesus just simply says, I'm sorry. You must have forgotten. You must have forgotten what the Word of God says. See, the Word of God says, and he reminds the enemy what the Word of God says. And then the enemy says, okay, all right. Well, doesn't the Word of God also say? And he goes, no. You forgot that the Word of God says. And then on the third time, he's not patient with him anymore and says, hey, listen, Jack, that's enough. Remember, he's God, and remember the Word of God. I know you know it. So you're going to have to shut it. And you know what happens? The enemy flees. He shuts his mouth and he flees. The Bible says, because that's what has to happen when you remember. James 4, verse 7 says, submit yourself to God. Remember who he is. Remember what he's done. Remember whose you are. Submit yourself to God. Resist the devil. And what's the promise? And he will flee. Not on the right day, not when you really need it, not when you're just desperate, but he will flee. He must flee when you remember. And so that's why the church for hundreds and hundreds of years has participated in Lent. A season where we calm some of the distractions, we slow down our pace just a bit. We leave a little more space for silence and for listening, for praying, and for reflecting on God's word. All so we will remember. Because the early church knew about busyness. They knew about distractions. They knew about the tricks of the enemy. You won't just curse God? Okay, fine. Let me have you forget about him for a while. Let me just move you in other directions. Let me just busy you up just enough so that you forget your first love. Also, we will remember in Lent how good our God is and how devastating our sin is. Our Ash Wednesday passage was found in Joel 2, and in verse 12 it says this: so God calls to his rebellious, forgetful, sinful people, and he says, but even now I'm giving you the opportunity to return to me. Return on back and remember me. Return with fasting and weeping and mourning. And then your young men will dream dreams and your older ones will see visions. And then I will restore and revive and breathe new life into you again. God's call to us in Lent is a simple one. Remember me, he's calling. Remember me and don't forget. Remember my loving kindness. Remember my grace, my mercy. Remember what my son did up on that cross, and don't forget. And as you remember, you will be able to resist the tempter and he will flee. And you, will, in your remembering, will draw close to my side, and on Resurrection Sunday, you will celebrate like no other day because you remembered all that God has done, all that he is, all that he will be. Remember how much I love you, he whispers this Lenten season. And I don't know of a better way to begin that journey in Lent than to be invited and gather around his table. To come around the Father's table and remember how kind his Son, the Christ, has been to all of us. You know what this table says, right? If you've been here long enough, maybe you've seen underneath the curtain. You know what this table says right here? When you come to this table, remember me. Do this, and as often as you do this, remember me. Don't forget. Don't be so distracted by all the things, even important things, even some spiritualized things, the busyness and the to-do list, that you forget. And when the tempter comes close, be like that faithful wife who says, wait a minute. I remember. So as the communion servers come forward, I want to let you know, this is the Lord's table. It's open and available to you. You don't have to be healthy or right or finished or whole to eat and drink with the family of God. You may have forgotten. You may be in a season of your life where you just sit here and you go, "Stretch, I've been forgetting." But if today you are aware of your need of Christ, if today you remember, then you're invited to this table. Maybe for some of you, it wasn't forgetting, it was just ignorance, like you just never knew. Today you're aware of it and you say, "Oh, I want to be a part of that remembrance celebration." Then this table is for you. Open up your heart to the love of God. Tell him you want to live like his son, Jesus Christ, and receive forgiveness for your sins. receive these elements, become part of the body of Christ, be washed by the blood of the Lamb, and enjoy your new life in Christ. Today, your spiritual birthday. So after Jesus finished washing the disciples' feet and as a symbol of his servant leadership in the world and to the church, he then passed the bread and the cup. And so let's do that together. We're gonna pass out the bread and the cup. And then hold them and just spend some quiet time praying, remembering. And maybe for some of you, you're introducing yourself back to your Creator for the first time. Remember.